Forgotten Females, Christine de Pizan, one of the world's first paid female authors. Hello and welcome to this episode of my Forgotten Females playlist of hidden history, the channel that explores what the textbook ignores. I'm your host, Andrea Redlin. I am an author, graphic arts student, history lover, obviously, and I love diving into the weirder details of history you will not find in the textbooks. The weirder, the better. Now that I've created a few episodes, I thought I should mention that my primary drive is helping people learn about history without being bored to death. I'm looking at you, high school students. I know how you feel. Sometimes learning things out of a book can be tough, as we don't all learn the same way. And that's fine. What's not fine is everyone in school being expected to learn the same way. Some of us learn better through visual and audio aids. Whatever it takes, as long as you're learning, that's all that matters. But I think a bit of fun matters too. In fact, it might even matter more, because if it ain't fun, it won't get done. So if you know of any high school students who could use a boost when it comes to studying for that upcoming test, maybe have them visit my channel. I'll be here. So, in today's episode, come with me as we head back once again in time to, the Middle Ages, the Late Middle Ages, where we will meet a gal by the name of Christine Pizan. I really wanted to visit ancient Rome this time, but since my time machine is being kind of finicky, it's the Middle Ages again it is. If you love this time period as much as I do, you might like my episode about Robin Hood, which I've linked below in the comments. As always, sources vary in their time and dates, you know, conflicting material. So if you hear any inconsistencies, it's not my fault, people. Don't shoot the messenger. Okay, Christine de Pizan, originally born Christina da Pisano, was an Italian medieval author known for being, and I quote, the only known professional author in medieval Europe who was a woman, unquote. She was also known as the first feminist philosopher. Not many women were formally educated back then, so the fact that she was able to read and write was a huge accomplishment. So instead of groaning about having to study for that upcoming math final, maybe just be grateful that you in the modern age are given the gift of learning freely, or if you're in college, not so freely, because over the course of history, education has been denied to millions of people, and not just women. Christine was originally born in Venice, Italy in 1364-65 in the city of Pisano, Italy to the Benvenuto family. Just for clarification here, when you see an Italian name with a d-something after it, the d-something usually refers to the city they came from, like Da Vinci. They later moved to France. Her dad had an unusual profession. He was both physician and astrologer to the king himself, Charles V. So, you know his family was not poor. This is probably the main reason his daughter was able to become so well educated, as books were generally available to those who had money in those days. Those of you who whine about having to read a certain book for English class, just shut up already and be grateful that you can read, okay? Because in our time, anyone can afford it, and that was not always the case. So Christine loved books from an early age. She spent her childhood in the French court, which was probably, in her opinion, the best perk of her father's boss being the king. It must have been a very exciting, pleasurable life for a young girl. Imagine roaming around a palace at will, wearing beautiful clothing, not having to work, and reading everything you ever wanted to read. Sign me up, please. So Christine married at 15. She married court notary Etienne de Castel, and they had three children. So life seemed good. Christine was in love. She had three kids. She wasn't broke. But things began to change about 5 years later. The first blow was when Christine's father died of illness when she was about 20 years old. And that's pretty young to lose a parent in our time, but back then, you were probably lucky to still have your parents after you reached adulthood. Most people probably never even met their grandparents then. So after the death of her father, it was up to Christine and her husband to financially support the remaining family members. But not long after, things got even worse. According to different sources, when Christine was between 20 to 24 years old, her husband suddenly took ill and died of the plague, otherwise known as the Black Death, leaving her with the 3 children to raise. Remind me to do a video on the Black Death. Many sources I've looked at, it must be noted that in one of them, it was stated that her husband died first, but most of them say it was her father. Let's just focus on the fact that she lost both of them in a very, very short space of time, which sucks. I hope that never happens to me, because my father and my husband are only 10 years apart, so it's a very real possibility, but I digress. Devastated by the loss of Etienne, she knew she was now the only person left who could support her family. Widows often turned to prostitution, sewing, being a laundress, or other jobs that were backbreaking and paid very little. But being raised as a noblewoman, however, those avenues probably would have been closed to her because they would have been thought to be below her dignity. She could have also remarried, which was something widowed people often did, but that would have posed another problem, because any property that had belonged to her deceased husband would have, by law, reverted to her new husband, because married women weren't allowed to own property. Your husband had to die first, then it was yours. So instead of doing what people expected of her, like get remarried, Christine chose to do something a little different, which I applaud her for. She began writing poetry and prose and sending copies of the works to members of the king's court. Remember, she grew up in the court, so she was kind of well known even before her writing began. Her works began as poems kind of like lamenting her lost love, but soon evolved into works that championed the rights of women. And if you're a woman, think about all the things you're allowed to do today, which is pretty much anything you want. But if you were a woman in the Middle Ages, there was many things you could not do, such as own property, participate in public life, or even manage your own children without your husband's permission. Ouch. In time, the popularity of Christine's writing led to commissions. The money she earned from those helped pull her family out of debt, in addition to all the translation work she was given. I want to point out that even if she had not been financially successful with her writing, and she was, at least she tried. She found out what the results of her efforts were, whether they were positive or negative, which is something a lot of talented people never do, because they're too scared of failure. But failure is 100 times better than having regrets for not trying at all. Bravo, Christine. Christine's most famous work is The Book of the City of Ladies, which kind of resembles this Forgotten Females playlist in regards to the fact that it gives a voice to women who are often kept in the shadows. It was published in 1405 and it is still available today, just like on Amazon. I haven't yet read it, but I plan to, and I have linked it below for your convenience. I have a feeling this book will become a prime source of the medieval side of the Forgotten Females playlist, just a hunch. Anyways, this book is very unique because it's the first history book about women written by a woman. For the very first time, people could read about women's history without biased male authors painting women in a negative light, since that often happened, women being considered second-class citizens and all. And sadly, women in some parts of the world are still treated this way just because they happen to be women. After France lost the Battle of Agincourt? I don't know. I don't speak French, people. I'm sorry. In 1415, the battle was lost. Christine retired to a convent located in Poissy, France. Again, I do not pronounce French. I am sorry. So she retired to this convent between 1415 and 1418. Her very last work, written in 1429, was about Joan of Arc, who was burned at the stake that same year. Pisan died in about 1430 or 1431. She was 65 years old, which was pretty old for the time period. I know I've mentioned this before, but the average lifespan of a person back then was 33, and Pisan's age was about double that. I was not able to find out her cause of death in the many sources I looked at, but we can probably assume it was a combination of old age and perhaps an illness in a time when effective medicine was almost non-existent. The final chapter, Pisan's legacy. Christine was very fortunate for a woman in her era. Not only did her father make sure that she was well educated, but her husband actually encouraged and supported her efforts to further her education, something that was rather unheard of back then. Actually, many things were unheard of back then, but let's just keep going. Women were pretty much just baby-making property at that time, of their property of their fathers and husbands in the Middle Ages, so if you had been a woman living back then, Christine's circumstances were probably the best you could hope for in life. I also wanted to add here that Christine and her husband were very much in love, despite the fact that it had been an arranged marriage that had brought them together. Actually, loving your spouse was also unheard of in that time, because marriage was more of a business transaction than anything else. As much as I wish I could travel back in time, I'm glad we live in an era where most of us get to choose who we marry. Forced marriages most of the time never made anybody happy except the bride and groom's parents, but that's the way it was. So what were Christine's most famous accomplishments? Number one, she challenged male authority. Her books were among the first, if not the first, to portray women in a more positive light and portray them honestly, not as how men actually saw them. Here's a quote on her thoughts. "One day I was surrounded by books of all kinds. My mind dwelt at length on the opinions of various authors whom I'd studied. It made me wonder how it happened that so many different men, and learned men among them, have been and are so inclined to express so many wicked insults about women and their behavior. It seems that they all speak from one and the same mouth. Thinking deeply about these matters, I began to examine my character and conduct as a woman, and, similarly, I considered other women whose company I frequently kept, princesses, great ladies, women of the middle and lower classes, who had told me of their most private and intimate thoughts. No matter how long I studied the problem, I could not see or realize how the male writer's claims could be true when compared to the natural behavior and character of women." Unquote. So basically, Christine was angry, for good reason, that women were being written about without the writers ever taking the time to get to know what their lives were really like. Remember, women were considered second-class citizens, so hardly any men ever asked their opinion about anything. And because women lived in such oppression and were not taught to read, so they in turn could not read books where a bunch of crap was being written about them, there were few who had the ability to stand up for themselves. Good thing we had Christine to do it for us. Number two, she stood up for the rights of women, including the protection of widows and the rights of young girls to have an education. This really doesn't surprise me, as she was once a young girl who valued an education and later was a widow. This is a quote from her book, The City of Ladies. "I am amazed by the opinion of some men who claim that they do not want their daughters or wives to be educated because they would be ruined as a result. Not all men, and especially the wisest, share the opinion that it is bad for women to be educated. But it is very true that many foolish men have claimed this because it upset them that women knew more than they did." Unquote. Yikes, we wouldn't want them knights in shining armor to feel intimidated by the smart damsels now, would we? Okay, moving on. Number three, she produced over 60 known manuscripts, about 50 of which survive today. This accomplishment is an immense feat for any era, even ours, and I shall explain why. A little known fact about writing, not even known to most writers, is that out of all the people who begin writing a book, only 3% of those people actually finish the book to completion. Just let that sink in for a moment. I've known a lot of writers over the years. I've been writing since I was 13, so I've had lots of time. I run a writing group on Facebook that I have linked below that has over 1,000 people in it, which is great. What's not so great is that a staggering 97% of these people will fall into the statistic of never finishing a single manuscript. I created this group in order to reduce that number. I want everyone there to find the help and motivation they need to finish their first book. Because as all writers know, there is nothing easy about writing except for opening up that laptop or brewing that extra strong cup of coffee that you hope will get you through that all-night writing session. And here's a little secret for you. If you want to get in my writing group, All you have to do is agree to follow the group rules, and boom, you're in. It's really not that tough. I don't know why at least half of the requests don't even respond to that simple yes or no answer question, but okay. So, writing group, agree, you in. Got it? Alrighty. In conclusion, Christine de Pizan became a huge inspiration to other female writers of the time. Her mission was continued by a 15th century woman named Laura Sarita, a woman who went on to publish such works as Collected Letters of a Renaissance Feminist, a book that, in short, also stood up for the rights of women to educate themselves, wear what they wanted to wear, and be able to make their own decisions after marriage. And probably before marriage too, I should think. One thing I've learned about Christine in doing my research about her is that she had both sass and was very direct, two qualities I admire. I wonder why. Though she wrote this section about Joan of Arc almost 6 centuries ago, it's lost none of its punch. Just listen to this. Quote, Joan of Arc drives her enemies out of France, recapturing castles and towns. Never did anyone see greater strength, even in hundreds of thousands of men. What honor for the female sex. The whole kingdom, now recovered and made safe by a woman. And so, you English, draw in your horns. A short time ago, when you looked so fierce, you had no idea that this would be so. You thought you had already conquered France and that she must remain yours. Things have turned out otherwise, you treacherous lot. Go and beat your drums elsewhere, unless you want to taste death, like your companions. Unquote. That entire speech made me want to draw in my own horns. Christine must have been one badass lady, even by our standards. As a female writer myself, it's been quite instrumental for me to have these long-ago female writers to look up to. Because, I think of it this way, if they can succeed despite all the obstacles of their time, and so can I, and so can you, if you're willing to work your butt off. I'll tell you right now, great accomplishments do not come to those who are lazy. Whoever you are, whatever you are, male, female, non-binary, etc., etc., get off your butt and work toward that dream of yours, whatever it is. Remember, failure never hurts as much as regret for never trying. Well, my hidden ones, that's all I've got for you today in this Forgotten Females episode of Hidden History. It's been wonderful having you all here, and as always, I definitely appreciate a share, please. If you know of any forgotten females you'd like the world to know about, drop me a line in the comments. Until next time, stay hidden. This video was sponsored by Winter Moon Designs, linked below, where you will find apparel, gifts, housewares, and hidden history merchandise. Woohoo! I also invite you to check out my women's humor book called Life is Short, So Lick the Bowl, Candid Confessions of 21st Century Womanhood. We hope you'll continue to support the channel and make it possible to create more exciting content just for you. Thanks for watching!